The inflation debate is compounded by the lack of an economic theory of inflation that still has forecasting usefulness. Once there was monetarism, but the money supply theory of inflation stopped working once the link between any definition of money and how consumers purchased goods and services was broken. That is, back in the 1950s and 60s, one could only purchase goods and services with the cash in one's wallet or a check written on a bank account. This was before asset management accounts, widespread credit card usage, smartphones, electronic payments, etc. The money supply, regardless of how one wants to define it now, stopped being related to inflation in the early 1980s. When central banks expand their asset purchases, they can create price inflation, but there is no relationship to future goods and service inflation. During the 1970s, many economists locked into the cost-push theory of inflation, and some still do. With cost-push, the focus is on labor markets as leading indicators of inflation. If the labor market is tight and the unemployment rate is very low, then this idea suggests wages may rise, costs of goods and services then rise, and general inflation follows. There was some evidence in the data of the 1970s for this idea, not so much in the 1980s. Since the early 1990s, there has been little to no statistical relationship between wages or unemployment that could be used to forecast future inflation. International theories focus on exchange rate movements. The gold standard was thought to promote price stability and was the concept behind the creation of the post-World War II Bretton Woods era of the U.S. dollar fixed exchange rate system. Once the world abandoned fixed exchange rates in the early 1970s, the international theory saw a persistent and meaningful decline in the value of a country's currency as a precursor to inflation. In the 1970s, the weakness of the U.S. dollar was thought to have created a vicious cycle of more inflation leading to more U.S. dollar weakness, leading to more inflation, and so on. The inflation data from developing countries still strongly supports a link between persistent exchange rate weakness and inflation. Among the major currencies, the U.S. dollar, the euro, the Japanese yen, since the 1990s, there has not been much of an observable link between currency moves and inflation. Supply shocks, such as the world is witnessing now, are not thought to create persistent inflation. Just a one-time price adjustment, which may take a year or two to work through, depending on the magnitude of the disruption to supply. War typically leads to inflation because governments ramp up spending on equipment and people. When the war is over, the inflation goes away. Our bottom line is that one needs a powerful and persistent driver of excess demand for goods and services to go beyond short-run supply shocks and create an era of inflation. The jury is still out as to whether pandemic-inspired expansionary fiscal and monetary policies will produce 1970s-style inflation. I'm Blue Putnam, Chief Economist, CME Group.